Hello everyone and welcome back to another Flip That Zoo series. So today we are going to jump in and work on more of our Twilight Pack. Right now I'm just doing some education for our animals we already have in place, which is our raccoons and our foxes and our bats. Super excited about getting these guys in there. We are going to be working on some other bigger projects, which I'm super excited for. It also made this video a bit longer than I usually try to keep them for the series. I usually try to keep around 30 for the series, but this one's gonna be, a little bit longer. But I feel like it's worth it. I didn't want to speed up too much too fast. So education is something we're definitely lacking in the zoo, and it's why we don't have 5 stars is because of our education and marketing. I'm gonna have to boost up my marketing. I'll do that offline though. You guys don't need to sit through that mess unless you have questions about marketing. If you don't understand it, just feel free to ask questions. But honestly, it's just flipping them on. But if you don't know how that works, let me know and I'll be happy to show you. I am putting education outside the bats. I did not realize a couple things while doing this. It is outside of the power range, so I do have to fix some power issues I'm having in this build. And B, they don't sit outside of the habitat. Of the exhibit. I thought it did, but I was wrong. You actually have to stick those inside the exhibit for them to count as education for that animal, which I think is kind of interesting. I would like to see it before I walk in. If I were a consumer, and I really wish we had the option to put like one inside and a couple outside, maybe even one of the bigger ones inside would be nice, but we have to use these little bitty stand ones. Once again, no power there, so that is gonna have to be rectified, which I think it kind of threw me because these lights are flame, so in my mind I was like, oh, we have power, look, the lights are working. No, that's not why the lights are working. But then going inside, and we're doing some finishing touches, some detailing on some of the habitat for the raccoons. And we're, I love these mushrooms that we got in the Twilight Pack. They glow and they light up in the dark. And I didn't know that when I first started placing them. And I thought they were so cool because I was placing them at night. I took care of some maintenance stuff. That's why it's daytime now. I took care of some maintenance stuff so that we could use the light while building and while managing stuff, because it's hard to manage things in the dark. But then it's kind of funny because later on in this episode I'm going to be wishing it was nighttime, because I can see all the cool night things that we're using in our build. So this is the foxes. This was, of course, a lion sanctuary area, so I had to kind of get rid of some of the educational stuff that doesn't pertain to foxes, and then make sure I have the proper things for the foxes put in here. So I'm checking all of the education items, making sure they all fit for foxes. I missed that zebra right there. I think I go back and get that here in a minute. If not, I will get it before we fully launch this area 100%. You'll see the money kind of fluctuating here and there as we go, but look at that. Look at our cash, guys. We are at over $1 million. We are definitely taking the right steps in the right direction as far as getting our zoo up to par, getting it to where it's happy, and where customers are happy. Customers are coming in. They're excited about seeing the things they're seeing. I did share this board with the raccoons and the foxes so that they could see both while on that trail. Then I checked for escape routes, which there happened to be a couple, and that's just because of the border placing, not necessarily because they can scale that wall, because they can't. That wall's intense. So sorry for the zoomies there. That was me trying to check out the area to see where I wanted to move the boundaries to, because I think this is the boundary for the raccoons as well, so you have to be very careful in placement. Back in the day, when we first got PlanetZoo, we used to be able to move these through the walls with the walls there. Now you have to place them and put the walls kind of in this weird U shape around them. I can add rocks if needed, but it looks like I took care of the escape issue or the boundary issue. I'll revisit if I ever need to. If I ever get alerts saying they've escaped, I'll just be sure to add some rocks to the edging. I don't anticipate having that issue again, but once again, time will tell. And then this is just adding toys and enrichment for them because they, you know, they need it to get higher scores, higher percentages for their for them being in this habitat. I want them to be as high as possible so we can get 5-star ratings on them and keep them, you know, in a good mood and joyous, etc. We want happy foxes. So if you don't know how to do this, you just click on an animal and you look at their enrichment, which is the fourth tab over, and you can look at the scores you're getting for each enrichment item you're placing. You can see which ones they're needing more and what they like more, which you can also look at in the clipboard, which is the very first tab on the animal, and you can see what percentages you're hitting for enrichment. So I realized they couldn't cross this little bridge that was here because it, you know, previously it was lions, and lions can obviously jump and climb better than little foxes can. So I just rearranged this tree stub a little bit just to be sure the foxes could get in and have a crossing of that barrier easily. I mean, they can swim, so they could just dive into the water and, you know, cross that way. But it gives them a cute little way to cross over if they so desire. And then we need to make sure we're getting education, so I was sure to put a board in, I don't think I ever put one in for the lions, I can't remember if I did or not, so I added one for the foxes here, and then I checked, using the H key, I checked education for the little sound systems, that give the information verbally, and they were off as well, so I plopped those on real quick, and we're looking good in this area. Full education. And after education, we're going to be moving on to resolving some other little issues that we're having, which is power. Because you notice this still has no power. I think I just realized it when I was checking education. I was like, that's still not on. So this is what I realized. We need power. And these little solar panels are nice, but they don't work as well as I wish they did for coverage. So in the back here, where no guest is going to go, because I'm making all that back 100% staffing, I'm actually going to be adding some staff buildings and some care buildings back here in the back where all these power things are. I decided to add a big power generator that would cover more area, more surface area, because I don't want to have any more power outlets in our little spooky village. I would like to actually take one away, not add any more. So then I add some coverage so that viewers can't see it from where they're standing. Nice little rock work and some beautification. So basically we're going to start finalizing and making pretty the water feature area, which includes these rocks and these trees, and then we start doing some flower work using, I'm gonna say, 90% Twilight Pack for this area, because I love the foliage that came with the Twilight Pack. Not a lot came with it. It was very minimalistic, but they're so pretty. So then, you know, duplicate patching makes you can get large fields of flowers fast. And while I was doing this, I was like, oh, I need to finalize and finish up the water feature, which I still haven't finished up. So power issues are now fixed, and now it's time to finalize and spruce up the water area, the water feature, because basically I'm tying up all the loose ends from our previous build so that we can start moving forward in the next part of our build. So this is really just me putting polishes on everything we've done so far. And I decided kind of early on when I started recording this episode, or when I started, you know, creating for this episode, that I wasn't going to limit myself on time. That I'm like, you know, if this ends up being an hour and a half episode. But I wanted to make sure some of this stuff was finalized so we wouldn't have to keep coming back to work on it. So this area where the bats, the raccoons, and the foxes live is going to be polished and done this episode. We will still be working on the next section that I have built. It is not polished. It is partially polished, but I really want to get some of our other animals from the Twilight Pack, and so it's not done. I'm not going to say it's done, even though it ends up looking really, really good. Fine detailing around the the fencing area, just to make sure, because, you know, you're going to have plants popping around the fences. And if they're pretty plants, the gardeners don't tend to kill them off or get rid of them. So I'm now surrounding the water areas with more rock because I feel like it gives it some structure and some things for the water to bounce off of. So I'm kind of looking at it there just to see how it plays with the water. And I love this water feature. I think it's actually really, really pretty. I think it brings kind of something else to look at as far as this area goes, because it is pretty much all just spooky tangled weeds, which I love, by the way. Those branches, those twisty branches are so fun, and so I actually find them beautiful. And we're just polishing up this area. So if you have the Twilight Pack, what is your favorite animal from the Twilight Pack? I am not choosing an animal favorite yet. While I'm still putting animals in, I'm also not building with them offline, like off stream. I'm not grabbing additional animals in other builds. I want to finish them out with this build first. And but I think I'm leaning toward the raccoons, because those little blonde raccoons are so cute. I just absolutely love them. They're so precious. Also, what are you guys thinking about this build so far? I realized while doing this part that water is not really high enough. And I know that no guests can see up there. I'm very well aware that guests cannot see up there, and it's not going to bother them whatsoever. But it was bothering my realism stance. So I do end up fixing this up. I think I kind of tried to speed through it just a bit so you guys wouldn't have to stare at me fiddling with water forever. But I didn't speed it up too much. I want you guys to be able to see the process I went through and how I got to where I was at. So this is us fixing the water, because as you can see, it won't go high enough in my opinion. So I fiddle with it a bit, and then I'm like, well, I'm just going to have to go back and do what I usually do for water, which is take a glass barrier, basically build a bowl, fill it up with water, and then build around it, make it pretty around it. So you're gonna see me fiddling with this for a little bit. There are probably other faster, better ways to do this, but this is how I do it. So I always say go with what you know, but if you guys have a faster, better way that you're confident that I'd be able to pick up just from you explaining it via, you know, text, feel free to drop it in comments. I'd be happy to look at it. I have had a few people give me hints and tips on stuff, and they've really worked. So I've picked up some tips, especially from like my friend's Mathlete, who has shown me a few things. Happy to learn. Always happy to learn. You can always learn more. I always say that there is nothing stagnant in this game. The minute you think you know something, you can learn a different or better way to do it. So this is just me finalizing the water, getting it all filled up in here, getting it where I want it. Not high enough. That's better. So now that it's at the height where I want it, all I gotta do is just lower down the glass pieces. Some of them are individual because I forgot to set the flat top setting on the glass, because I was just going and I just forgot to change my settings. So it doesn't always look that janky. I just forgot to change settings, so I was like, well, I'm already here, so I'm gonna just go with it. Which, you know, it happens sometimes. Sometimes when you're just not in the mood to mess with the fiddling with it anymore, you just kind of go with it. Which reminds me, there's something else about this episode of this series you're going to see me going back and forth with areas a little bit, and that's mainly because one of my basically big things that I always tell everybody when they're playing this game is if it's driving you crazy, if you keep fixing it and it's not fixing, take a break from it, do something else, get your joy back, and then return to it and try again. So that's often why some of these things aren't polished, because or right out the gate, is because my brain is tired of dealing with it, so I put it down. It's kind of like playing with a Rubik's Cube. I put it down, and then I'll come back to it later. I will solve that problem later. It's like, I know the problem needs to be solved. I am aware that it's a problem. I need a break from the problem. So I recommend that if you're playing this game and you find yourself frustrated because you've tried building, I don't know, this wall or this rock structure or this water feature you're seeing in your head but you can't seem to get it right, I recommend taking a break. If it's just driving you absolute batty and you've been doing it for hours, take a break from it. Walk away, go do something else, get a drink or whatever, and then come back. And sometimes it'll really replenish you. It'll give your brain a moment to basically hit reset. So that's how I build. Sometimes I will hyper focus and stick on one area for a little bit longer than I probably should, but I try to make sure that I take breaks in between some of these builds, or in between some of these areas that I'm building when I feel like my brain is turning into pudding and I just can't look at it anymore. Anyway, so we are now going to go back into detailing some more of this bad cave, because I like the outside of it. I like how I have framed it. I like how it looks like a cave instead of just metal or glass or whatnot, or a big black box. So now I'm in here just detailing some parts of it, making that look great, basically beautifying the bats. And I did make a little error there. I forgot to hit the check mark or the accept button. And I didn't cut it out. I'll let you guys see. You know, we all make mistakes. So I had to go back, select it, twist it again, and this time hit enter, which accepts it. And this is me looking at this area where I wanted a castle. So I plopped this entrance castle piece, which does come in the game. I am aware that I did not build this myself, because it was already built and it was already just what I wanted. So I figured I would just tweak it, mess with it, and make it my own. Which is what I do. And I recommend that too. Like, if you want something and there's already a build already prepared for it that comes with the game, like it is a game thing that already came with it, why not use it? And then this is me adjusting the bathrooms, making it look good. It's not quite where I want it yet, but I will figure it out later. I was like, I don't know how I want this yet. So I figured I would fiddle more with the rest of it and come back to it, because sometimes you don't know how you want it to lay until later on. I'm setting up the pathing, attaching everything, and then realizing this is a mistake later on, I will remove that. But I'm trying to not just skip past the mistakes I make, so you guys can see what I did and what I did wrong, and some of you are probably like, don't do that, that's not right. Don't worry, I will notice. It'll happen, it'll clue in, or maybe it's already clued in and I'm just like, I will deal with that later. I am very much a fan of I will deal with that later. That was one of the power structures we had that I realized I didn't need in the game, so I took it out. And I just checked to make sure we still had power, make sure everything still looks good, and then back to clearing this area out. I was like, nope, this doesn't quite fit our build anymore, so we're getting rid of that. I was trying to make it to where everything is cohesive in that area. I'm making like a little front plaza area, and then there's going to be a back courtyard area. It's going to look really, really nice. I love this build. I think this is one of my favorite areas that I have made in this park so far. I wish we could change the donation bins to look a little... I mean, I know I can paint them or color them, which I probably will, but I wish we could change the shape of them or make them different. I might end up coating them in an item or something. I'm not sure yet. My original thought is to take one of those cauldrons and stick a cauldron around it, but then that's using a trash can, so my donation bins look like trash. And that won't work. So this is a zoo entrance area. That's what this build is. It's a zoo entrance. And I was trying to decide, I was like, you know what? No, I don't want this to be an entrance. I'm just going to have this be a walkthrough. It'll be fine. And I'm thinking about it and I'm looking at it and I'm like, wait, this is a spawning point. I decide that I kind of like having a little spawn point here. It'll bring more people into my zoo. It'll give a whole other section they can enter through. So I decided to undo what I had just done, delete the undoing of the entrance. And then I realized I have to get rid of this walkthrough. And I have to get rid of the one that I created for the bathroom, which you'll see me do in a second. Because I don't want them entering, not paying, and going in through the back. Because that would be kind of fruitless for them to enter my zoo and not pay. Because we're here to make money. Otherwise, I can't feed my animals. So I was just making sure I didn't mess up anything with the structure, and I didn't. So I've got that in place. Now, looking at this, I'm thinking, even though it's definitely not to size, I want this castle to have wings. I don't want it to be all squished together. So I decided I need to move this. So get rid of those paths. And this needs to get slid over a little bit to give the castle like a wing tower, basically. And I want one on the other side too. I just haven't figured out how to do it in my head yet. So you'll see that later on. And that to me is much more what I was looking for. So I'm happy with that. And then I tried to decide whether I want a path attaching these. I tried it out for a second, hated it, deleted it, and went back to just the way it is now. I would rather people go into single file lines through the entrance and the exit versus going across from the toilets. I think that would just be weird. So I don't want to move these shops. I think they're in a good place. I'm just trying to frame them a bit so that they're not as visible. So we'll be working on that as we go along. And there's some other prefab pieces I was looking at to see if I wanted any of them. I decided no, but I do want to get this other wing on. I just have to figure out where I want it. And I kind of figured out that I want it there, but then I've got to figure out how to get it there. So basically reworking the pathwork, which is great. I actually think it ends up better this way, honestly. It is not going to be another set of toilets. I just am using the same prefab so that it matches the other side. And then I'm going to make it my own here in just a second, or maybe shortly. I'm not sure if I'm doing it right away or in a minute, but I feel like this gives a much more of a castle-y vibe, I guess you could say. So getting rid of the toilets because I don't want it to be toilets, and the framework because, once again, I don't want that. I left those side frames on the doors, but I'm kind of thinking I'm going to get rid of them. I think they look a little weird. I haven't got rid of them yet. I don't think I even got rid of them before the end of this build, but now that I'm looking at this through the recording, I'm thinking I'm going to get rid of them because they look a little funky. I might keep them. I don't know. What do you guys think? Should I get rid of those wooden pieces inside the doorways, or should I keep them? Inquiring minds, what do you guys think? So this is an area where I was like, maybe I should put a path through here. And then I was like, no, then they won't go through the archway. So I contemplated it for a minute, and then I ended up deleting it because I was like, I want them to have to go through the archway. Because it's kind of like, I want the forced experience. I want to force them to experience the castle. I guess is the best way to put that. But I did want to have a side entrance into the bats and into the raccoons. Basically funneling them in and through and around and making them come back to the courtyard, hopefully. And then that would bring them to the food and the drinks and everything else. And they would go back through the entrance to go around. That's if they do it that way. Or maybe they're coming from the lions and they're taking a left down that long corridor and coming in through the back entrance. This is another piece that comes with it. It's a prefabbed bat walkthrough habitat. I did not want more bats, so I got rid of the inside. I got rid of all of the stalactites, stalagmites, and all of the pre-cut fab work there. I really zoomed through this because you guys don't need to see me deleting a bunch of stuff in slow motion. And I'm going to repurpose this prefab. I'm going to make it my own. I'm going to take it apart. I am going to... basically, I'm keeping the bones is pretty much what I'm keeping. I'm keeping the bones because it's good bones. I start out with the exhibits because I want this to be an exhibit walkthrough. I wanted it to be like a back courtyard area where you come through and see the exhibits. So I start building the courtyard. I start putting the exhibits in. And then I realize, I think it's right around here, I was like, oh wow, this is actually really tight through here. I'm like, that makes me uncomfortable. But I'm like, you know what? Nope, I'm committing. I am going to put all these where they go. I am going to stretch it out. I'm going to check it out. And then I'll decide whether I keep it like this. I also wanted to finalize it and make it so-called pretty so I could see what the final piece would look like. I'm not quite sure what I'm doing here. But it looks like I'm just trying to see movement, like if I moved it, centered it, what it would be like as a walkthrough area. But I also don't want it popping through the walls on the outside. So just getting everything lined up and everything in the right place. Once again, it's a very, very thin walkway. And you guys can probably see me thinking about it like, wow, that is really thin. But I'm still pushing through. I'm still gonna try it anyway, just because I feel like I owe it to myself to at least try. So I put them in place and I'm looking at it and I'm like, this doesn't work. And there's still stalactites up there, so I start getting rid of some of those. So getting this place prepped for me to take it apart, which, by the way, I do apologize. When I take it apart, I actually, I got a phone call and I hit the stop recording button. And I forgot to restart the recording. So you are gonna miss me taking it like apart, breaking it in half, but really it's not super complicated. It was literally just me removing one half of the castle, duplicating that side, flipping it, and then it's just two separate pieces. That's really all you missed. Nothing, you know, life shattering or altering. But if you are confused by me saying that and want to see it, I can do like a separate video showing you guys how to break apart and reuse things you get prefab. I decided I don't like those closed off, so I'm gonna leave it open because I like the arch details. I think they're really, really pretty. And this is just me detailing the exhibits, trying to get all the pieces sitting right and making it work all in unison. I did speed this part up a little bit because I don't think you needed to watch me copy and raise, lower, and move around a bunch of concrete pieces. So this is me staring at it some more, and I've convinced myself I hate it. So I broke it up after my phone call and forgot to hit the record button, so my bad. But you didn't miss much. And I just created my own arch to stick here that kind of matched the other arches. As a walkthrough from the bat area over to this exhibit area. So if they want to go through and behind, they can. Just making sure there's no gaps. And here in a second, you're going to see what I did, how I split it in two. See how it's in half now? And this will give me the ability to put a nice little courtyard right there in between those two halved pieces. It was a very fun build. I was just trying to check out all my parameters, make sure I had everything the way I wanted it, set up any pieces that were missing, which I realized I cut off part of an arch, so I put that back. Which was a little more interesting to put back than you would think, but pretty easy. Like I said, once you learn how to copy paste some of these pieces, it all becomes super fast, super easy. It's not as complicated as your brain wants to tell you it is. Putting those torches back, because I think those are going to be important in the future, because we're going to have pathing all through here. And then realizing, I'm like, wait, I wasn't sure how I wanted to do the groundwork, so I tried using a line to grid, which wasn't really working. So you'll see me get rid of that in a second. It doesn't work right. It works kind of funky. So get rid of that. Put that back. And then I go ahead and grab the grid anyway and put the other tile pieces back in the middle, which I'm going to end up changing. Like, this is how these projects work. I have an idea in my head of how I want it to look, so I start trying to prep for how I want it to look, and then it's not quite right. So that is the beauty of this game. You can just kind of keep trying, keep chugging until you reach that part in your brain where you're like, yeah, this is kind of what I was going for. This is the look I was going for. Now I'm looking at it trying to decide if I want just those two rows of exhibits or if I want more than just the two rows, which you're going to see that I decide to add one in the middle here in just a second. So I took a break from that because it was frustrating me. So I decided to go ahead and do this back entrance like I wanted to and add a little feature piece like I wanted to, which is like a gate in the back where people could come in through the opposite side. I tried to have like basically three entrances into this courtyard area, so it's well used and it's well visited. I didn't want it to just be some place stuffed in the back where no one could see it or experience it, because I'm working really, really hard on this exhibit area, so I wanted it to be definitely seen, heard, noticed by people. And this is just me trying to fill it with the gate to see how I want it to go, and squishing it up to basically the courtyard castle exterior. And I think this gate is really cute. It came with the game pack, with the new DLC. And then at that point in time, my brain had had enough of a break to come back to the exhibits and put them in. See, like I said, jumping around a bit when you're trying to figure out what to do. I went ahead and put in the glass roofing that I knew I wanted over this courtyard area, because basically this exhibit area is going to be a place where people can come and get out of the rain and still see animals. So if we get rainstorms, I expect this place to be popping with people. I don't know about you guys, but when I'm out and I'm experiencing a zoo or an amusement park or something, if there is a place, I always notate in my head where the places are that have the coverage. And those are the places that I keep in mind that, you know, if I see rain clouds or something, I'm like, it might rain this afternoon. Hey, this house right here, this little exhibit house, fully covered. I think I should keep this in mind for where to come later. At this point in time, I'm going through pathing hell. I could have deleted this and, you know, shown you guys the finished project or finished product, but I decided I'm going to leave pathing hell in here. I want you guys to see that pathing doesn't always work out perfect for pretty much any of us. I have the best intentions. Like, I see it in my head and I know how I want it to be. For some reason, I cannot get it to go correctly. I hate that. That didn't work right, so back to the drawing board, you delete it, and you try again. I did end up finding a good enough method, which is to get kind of close to these exhibits. Not this one. This is the loser method. This is not it. Get close to the exhibits using your control key. You can hover with your pathing and get close to something without connecting to another path. And I was trying to fiddle with this and figure out what I wanted. So I will delete it again in a second. You guys will see. Pathing Hell is a real thing. If you guys have never gone through Pathing Hell, then have you played PlanetZoo? Just being honest here. I swear even the best of builders have gone through pathing nightmares. It happens to all of us. This, I think, is the moment when it clued in, like, what I should do with the pathing. I think this is where I got a moment of clarity. I want to say it was right here. Then I was like, oh, I know what I'm going to do with this now. And then I go back through and delete this, and basically do it again, but this time with my newfound method of drawing a path and connecting the exhibits. Which, by the way, so easy. Why didn't I notice that before? So then I was like, oh, just do the same thing with this other side. I didn't get it super close, so I think I actually ended up deleting. Do I end up deleting it? Or do I leave it alone? Sometimes after going crazy, you kind of just leave stuff alone. You know what? I think I left that one alone. That one actually looks good. And then I had to redo this side because I realized I was too close on that side. They all attach, and we're Gucci. It's not the world's best path. It's not. You know, I know some builders who can go in there and they can have it all attached with the grid and it's perfect. I tried the grid several times. It was not working for me. So I gave up on the grid and I just did the method that worked best for me. And sometimes that's just how you have to do it. Now, the cool thing is this pack came with things that are easy to help hide not so pretty pathing. So my main concern was getting the people to be able to walk to see the exhibits and to walk to experience the bathroom, snacks, stuff like that, without having to leave the area or meander around. So while there are a few patches in the floor, there's no meandering that's going to happen. They're going to be able to get from point A to point B, just not over those specific tiny little patches. But I basically fixed that in a little bit. This is where I'm just going to place all the exhibit animals. I did this one a little bit on the speedy side because I figured you just didn't need to see me placing 10 million exhibit animals. But the cool thing is, all seriousness put aside, I did move over those exhibits that were in the middle of the area with no casings, no coverings. They weren't pretty. They were just literally stuffed over in a walking path. So I moved those over. But these exhibits, the really, really cool thing is I have gotten every exhibit animal in the zoo minus, I think like three. I think I'm missing three. I'm going to go through the list again just to double check. But I'm basically missing red-eyed tree frogs, I think is the only thing I'm missing. Although I feel like I'm missing more. So I'm going to go through the Zoopedia. Laborer's task of going through the Zoopedia, comparing it to my list of animals and seeing what I'm missing and seeing what I have. And then while I'm in this area, I figured I would go ahead and check all of their temperatures and humidity and make sure everybody's set where they need to be so that I'm not off detailing or making some other part of the zoo while basically these creatures are either dying or everything's going into alarm or I'm having 10 million protesters because I haven't taken care of them. So I'm fixing all of that now, and then I realized I forgot to fill one exhibit, so I've got to fill that up real quick. I wasn't using my list, so I realized I was missing the sacred beetle, which is really sad. I only had one, and I haven't seen any other ones in the exhibit trading post. I don't know if that's just a creature that's hardly ever in there, but it's been 3 days and I have not seen another one enter the exhibit trading post. If anybody has basically a sacred beetle they would like to trade with me or give to me or whatever, can you let me know? All right, so on to more detailing. We're getting this back area pretty. We're getting it all set up. basically lighting is a big thing. This is where I was like, oh, yay, it's nighttime. Now I can see how the lights look and I can make things bright or, you know, more user friendly, because you don't want to be running into walls as a guest at a zoo if you're going to have it open during the nighttime, which we really need to have it open during the nighttime for this specific area. And then I realized I need more gargoyles on my castle. So I add some gargoyles and just basically making everything finite, getting it all pretty, getting it all set. And just detailing of the plaza, detailing of the exhibit area, which I'm kind of referring to as the plaza. So if you guys hear me say plaza, that's what I'm talking about. Then I also realized we needed to get education set up for these guys, because while we have the habitats themselves nice, people will have low education if you don't have everything set up. So I thought, while we're here, let's go ahead and get that done. I like to attach the speakers to these little exhibit pods, and if they're this close, if they're side by side, you have to lower the radius to 2. That is the only way you can get these side by side exhibits to have the speakers work properly. So if you are wondering what I'm doing, I'm every now and again I have to slide one left or right just to get it out of that pink area, that hot zone, just to make sure they're not tripping over each other. But I managed to get every exhibit has education. No one left behind in these exhibits. So just getting all these guys set up, and then I also made sure I put other types of education in here. I put some little things in for the kitties, and I also put in some, you know, basically endangered species materials for these habitats, or sorry, I keep calling them habitats, for these exhibits. I want to make sure people are fully educated, because that is something I've noticed on our happiness scale. People keep saying they're not fully educated. I do know that I do not have educators in this zoo, not really, so I'm wondering if I need to really push for some of those. I know PlanetZoo added, in this most recent update, they added where educators can now hold animals, and I want to say they were exhibit animals. I could be wrong, but I'm pretty darn sure they're exhibit animals, and if they are, then I definitely want to add at least one or two educators, probably 2 educators to this area, maybe even more than 2, maybe 3 educators. Maybe one at each entrance or each section. I'm not sure how to do this yet. We'll figure it out, but it is definitely a feature I'm going to look at to see if that is the way it works. And then we are going to be detailing this area even more, because like I said, I'm going to make it work to where those dirt patches aren't even noticed, aren't even seen. They just become a blip. They're not even anything that anybody cares about at some point. So these tables fit over them perfectly. You have to kind of arrange them just a bit to make sure that the middle of the table is over the patch. And so people can basically still sit around the table. It's just that middle patch gets ignored because people aren't going to have to walk over that because it's a huge table. Then I put these trash can cauldrons in, and then while I'm putting the cauldrons in, I'm like, oh, I know what detail would go great on these exhibits, which are these little metal posts that are supposed to go on fences, but I personally think they're a good little detail thing, which that's another thing about PlanetZoo, which I say it all the time, is just because something is supposed to be for something does not mean you can't use it for your own however you want. Just because it has a label does not mean you can't use it in a completely different way. So I took a break from the back because my brain was starting to get kind of muddled with it, because I knew I wanted something else, I just didn't know what. So I moved to the front courtyard area. The front plaza area, to put in leaves and trees and do some fine detailing work. While I'm scrolling through here looking at the fine detailing for this, I'm getting ideas for the back, for the courtyard. So basically moving to a different area and planning it out has allowed my brain to kind of just take a small break and go, ooh, see that item there? That would go good. Ooh, that item might go good. And that's what I meant by take a break. If you're getting stressed out over something, take a break from it and move on to the next. I love these wrought iron fences. I think they're so pretty. And I think this gives a nice little break from our trail, from our pathing. It also kind of gives it a spooky vibe where people are going to have to walk through the unknown to get to the other side. So I think that's also an extremely fun little detail. These leaves look fabulous in these courtyard areas because they cover the things that don't really fit in, which is the green grass doesn't really fit in this motif. So I'm covering all of that up, but I'm also kind of lining the edges of some of these walkthroughs because they're just kind of fun. And basically telling the workers, only sweep up the middle, leave the leaves alone, or sweep them out of the middle and sweep them off to the side. So then I decided to detail these entrance areas here, and this is where I started thinking, should I keep that wood there or should I get rid of it? You guys let me know what you think. Keep the wood that trims it, because I mean, it kind of goes with the bathroom, so if I took the trim off the other side, I'd have to take it off the bathroom side, I think, because I want them to be kind of matchy. So that's where my thought process is for leaving it. Then I realized I kind of wanted to put a couple of tables, if not three or four tables here, but unfortunately that gap was so big it wasn't going to work. So I knew I was going to have to close the gap up. I was hoping there was a natural pathing that I could cover it up with. There wasn't. So back to the, the old faithful, the walkthrough path that we're using everywhere, and laying more of these tables. And I think it really covers that area up nicely. So even though I am going to lay leaves all underneath it, it doesn't feel like I'm just laying leaves to mask a hole, basically. So it really feels like it gives it a purpose. So this plaza, I think, started really turning out nicely. I don't know if I'm done, because I feel like on this blank side where there is nothing, you're going to notice I haven't put leaves there or anything yet, because I don't know if I'm done with that side. There was a habitat there where we were putting our leftover lions, and I'm not sure how I want to use that area. I also covered up the transition of the two paths with a bunch of leaves because it just looked kind of funky. I loved this windmill build they had, and I didn't want to get rid of it, and coffee is life for me, so I kept the coffee. I just kind of detailed it myself, put a little bit of edging around it. I think, or maybe I'm wrong, that this was built with one of those stands in mind instead of one of these full-fledged buildings, but I went with the building. So I just trimmed it out myself, fixed it all up. You guys are going to see me doing that kind of quick, like realizing certain things aren't going to work, too tall, too big. So got rid of that and detailing it in small ways instead, adding in an extra bag of coffee, sliding the coffee around just a little bit. I think this windmill is so cute. I just couldn't get rid of it. I didn't want to try building my own because I love this one. I think it's done perfectly. It also kind of inspires me to build things around it or to detail around it. So that's why I'm thinking I want to put a habitat or more buildings for people to vibe in, maybe more restaurants or maybe a restaurant, more food court items. I'm not sure. I definitely think I want, I'm like 90% sure I want something to go there other than just off into blankness. So if you have any thoughts or ideas of what we should put there, maybe a small habitat with a restaurant, maybe just a restaurant itself, I'm not sure. Because on the other side of the lions is another restaurant. So how many restaurants do we have in our zoo? And does it matter? Should we have a fully spooky themed restaurant? It could be kind of fun. There is another prefab that came with this, which is like this bell tower looking thing. I could use that in a manor and then create a restaurant behind it, around it, underneath it, through it, possibly. Not sure yet. I love this prefab. It was too cute not to use. So I ended up sticking it right back here by this secondary entrance right here. I wasn't sure where to stick it. I was like, oh, I want this in my build. It's too cute. I love it. I don't think I've ever used this many prefabs before. But all the prefabs for the Twilight Pack are just so... I love them. I love every single one of them. So I felt like I just had to use them. Usually the prefabs are kind of like, oh, okay, well that's nice, but it's not something I feel like I have to have and I have to use and I want it in my zoo. It's usually like, well, that's nice. But these are just cute and fun and quirky and I love them. So they all got used. So that being said, I thought it'd be kind of nice to be able to walk around these. In this area, I'm also thinking I might end up sticking in like a little habitat. I think we have two more animals from the Twilight Pack we have to put in. And I like all the animals from the Twilight Pack, so I don't want to leave them out if possible. More janky pathing imperfections, but that's what leaves are for. For some reason, my little corner trick wasn't working here, so I tried it a few times. It didn't work, so I decided just to stop trying. I didn't delete this footage because I just thought you guys should see what I was trying and what I was doing. I thought about widening the path, but then I was like, you know what? If I'm thinking about putting in a little habitat here, I'll just leave it alone. Let's stop messing with it. Let's leave good enough alone. Let's not let perfect be the enemy of good. And move on to this little thing. Like I liked it, like how it was, but I felt like it wasn't going enough around for what I want, because I want to put some seating over here, and I also don't want people to go into the middle of this thing and possibly hurt themselves, etc. So I covered it up just a little bit more, because I'm thinking we're gonna have a lot of kids in this area. Because I don't know about you guys, but where I live, the spooky stuff is very popular to walk around and experience, so I definitely wanted to make sure it was kid safe. So we're just putting in some more leafing detailing. I kind of figured if I was going to cover it everywhere, I wanted to put it under the exhibits too. Like, I want this place to look 100% prepared, decked out, leaves galore. I edge everything with it because I think they just are too cute for this area. I don't really feel like they fit the area where the bats are, but I feel like they really fit this area. I think it's because it's more open and airy, more breezy, versus like the area where the bats and the raccoons are is all enclosed and cave-like, and I don't think the leaves are really going to be in there. And that's just my mentality. That's how my brain sees it. Making sure these are spread equally and all over the place. I did occasionally plop them on top of the table on accident, so I kept having to delete it and try again. Yeah, so this is a great way to detail if you're just trying to fill some space in your spooky walks or habitats or whatever. These are the leaves are great. They're really good for making the spaces feel very rounded out and less just paint terrain and more fun. Definitely more lively and fun. I put in some of those trees because what I want and the reason why I'm lining this thing with trees, and I'm probably going to even put more than that, is when people see the spooky place or the experience, I don't mind them getting little peeks here and there. It's kind of like I want them to really have a strong urge and desire to go back there to see what it is and why it's so hidden. It's kind of like, what is the secret area and why can't we see through it? Now, see, these are lanterns that are meant to be flipped over the other way, but I thought they looked kind of like those little garden stakes that you can buy. You can stick them in the ground and they use solar power usually to light up your pathways or whatever. So that's kind of what I did with them around here. I don't think that's what they were meant for. Actually, I'm rather certain that's not what they were meant for, but I thought it was neat. And then, of course, I do want to use them the way they were intended, which is with some chain work. This part can be frustrating if you're trying to eyeball it. So I'm going to show you guys a trick to how to still use a little bit of the eyeball method, but use logic to lay it all out for you so you're not struggling. So the trick to this is to lay out the areas where you want your lanterns to go. Like, where do you want them to hover? So I want three over each exhibit area, and then I just slid them until they were centered the way I like them. And then you grab the lantern and you dip it down into where you want it to be centered. And then you use your, basically your X, Y axis to slide it down in and then straight up. Because once it's on that axis, it won't change directions. Once it's going up and down, it's set to up and down. So just dip it down in and then axis and up. And it's always going to be right above those boxes you laid out. So it helps you keep everything organized, even, and just the way you wanted them versus trying to eyeball it and fidget with it and it's in the wrong place and it drives you crazy. Trust me, I've been there. I've driven myself mad from these things. So then I grab my boxes, I slide them over to the other exhibit, copy paste my lantern, slide them where I want them, and honestly, I started to just kind of put them in place first and then up, and there you go. And it's I find it as a really easy, fun trick. So if you guys have ever tried eyeballing this and driven yourself batty, do this trick. Trust me, it'll save your brain. You won't go insane anymore trying to line things up. Or maybe it's just me and maybe I'm weird and maybe these things only drive me insane. I can't imagine I'm the only one that goes insane when things aren't lining up perfectly the way that I want them. And I have turned these alerts off a million times, but they keep coming back. So sorry for the alerts that you guys keep seeing on the top left-hand side. I am aware that things are happening with animals and I have to fix animals and I have to stop them from fighting and all the fun things they do. But then you could just delete the boxes unless, of course, you want to keep them. I got rid of them. And then we are just going to fine detail the tops and bottoms of the exhibit. So it's a little bit speedy here because I figured you guys didn't need to see me sliding big brick pieces back and forth. So that is basically all I'm doing here is trim detailing. Fast, easy, not hard to do. I literally grabbed this big brick piece from the top. In all honesty, I did try a different method first to create some detailing. It didn't work, so that's why you're gonna see some vines or ivy, because that's something I was trying to use and it didn't work out the way I wanted it to. But I like the vine and ivy, so I didn't delete those. I decided to keep those. So this is me moving some of them just to put them where I want them and get them on those seams and those edges. And so this is the fine detailing of the exhibit. We do the tops and then I go and do the bottoms with a thinner piece after I fill out some more of the detailing area. I think I even put the pumpkins in first before I do the bottoms. I want to say I do the pumpkins first. You cannot have the spooky area and those really cute jack-o'-lanterns and pumpkins without wanting to put some of them in your zoo. At least not in my opinion, because I love pumpkins and jack-o'-lanterns. I think they're so cute and so fun. Really fun group activity to do. I also got rid of some of the long grass. I realized that this gate door wasn't sitting where I wanted it to, because it would be like people would have to walk through it in order to get in and out, which just looked funky. I might end up putting a rock under that gate. I'm not sure yet. We'll see how it goes. Basically fixing the detail work on this, because I realized they were a little off kilter. And I'm trying to really go through and fine detail everything before I end the stream, which is how we ended up with a really long video. So I do apologize for that. I know it's a little bit longer than I originally intended. And then I'm putting some railing on the pathing, making sure those are sitting where they're supposed to be. And then we put, I want to say put the pumpkins is. Yep. Then we put our pumpkin display in, because I felt like that middle one was just lacking, but I didn't want to put more twisty vines. I wanted something different. So I was like, ooh, pumpkin display. My only fear about this one is I'm pretty sure people can walk through them, but I really don't want to delete that pathing again. So I think I might just let it go and let it happen how it's going to happen. And then I wanted some normal pumpkins around the jack-o'-lanterns. Yes, they're all one color right now. They will randomize colors sometimes, But in my opinion, that doesn't work super well. So I just end up grabbing it each one individually and painting it myself, which you're going to see in just a moment. I managed to get a white one. I'm not sure how. So this is me repainting the pumpkins, putting them as different colors, which they come in, I think it's like three or four different colors that are color options, like color choices, which you can change. And so some of them I left bits and pieces the same. So they were spotty or stripey or whatever, like that one right there. I left the orange on because I like the stripe look. And then this one, more orangey, yellowy. And I think I made a purple one too. I want to say I made a purple. Yep, there we go. I made a purple one. Had a lot of fun with this little build. I thought it was really cute. And then I realized I needed to detail the bottom of the exhibits because everything else is covered in masonry except for the bottoms and it's metal. And it wasn't vibing with me. Once I put those pumpkins there, it felt like they just did not fit. So, I fixed this part too. I tried to zoom through this part too because I figured you guys weren't going to want to watch me put a bunch of bricks up for, you know, 10 million hours. Because it's a little bit of adjusting and getting those little detail pieces just right because you don't want them to look slightly off. I was trying to figure out how to fix this corner. So what I ended up doing was just kind of turning an edge to where it's almost like an angled corner piece instead of a flat piece. And I thought it worked really, really well. Finishing those up, making sure everything is covered, because we are we're looking good. I think this back area is just about complete. It's very detailed, very popped. I think it's looking nice and clean. I feel like, look at those bubbling cauldrons. Oh my gosh, they're so cool. I love them so much. If you guys haven't used the cauldrons yet, I recommend the green ones because when you press play, it spits up like this green, smoky, bubbly stuff, and it's just so fun. Ah, I love it. Okay, sorry. This, like I said, I think this is like one of my favorite build is this spooky area. I did mention earlier I put in education for the kiddos. This is what I was talking about. I put in the little paw things and the little games they can press and play. I realized basically the back area did not have any trash cans. I wanted to finish filling in some seating because I will tell you, they will complain if there's no place to sit. This little area behind these seats, I wanted to put a sign in just to let everybody know that if they wanted to see the creepy crawlies, they're this way. I might add maybe a spider or something to that sign. I'm not sure. And I wanted to detail this more so it broke off from the lions. It didn't look the same. I switched sides for the power. I double checked it to make sure it still worked. And then I was like, what's this missing? It's missing mist. It's missing that final spooky vibe. So I added mist literally everywhere. So as you're walking through anywhere in this twilight area, you are getting mist. If it's in the courtyard or if it's in the plaza, 100% misty. And let me show you guys what it looks like final run through. I personally think this turned out so good. It's so cute and it's obviously very popular. Look at all of these people crowding in here. The layout is lovely. It really gives an easy exit if you don't want to be in a spooky area. It allows you to walk back through, experience more of it. There's also like a little shortcut, so if you're just trying to get from point A to point B, like maybe the back of the lions, instead of having to walk all the way back around, you can instead cut through. Just look at this. It's just so beautiful. I am in love with this build so far, and just think, we still have at least one more video left, maybe two, because I'm thinking one or two habitats, so let me know what you guys think. See you guys next time.
I hope you guys liked it. Please subscribe. Thank you so much for coming. Ring that bell. All those really cool YouTube things. And I'll catch you guys in the next one.